Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the third season of the Next Floodcast.
It's the Fat Boys break up. Now every day I wake up, somebody got a problem with hope. What's up, y'all need to get all fed up, cause I got a little cheddar and my record's moving out the store.
We got a very special guest, Kyle Montgomery, also known as The Voice.
Worldwide and the 3X Free Road. Let's get it.
It's good to be here. It's good to be here. And thank y'all for switching up the podcast for me, going to English from Dutch. I do need to step my Dutch up, so maybe I need to take a couple steps y'all way. I appreciate it. It's good
it's
to
no
be
problem.
Here.
It's no problem.
Nice, man. Kyle, tell us about yourself. Who are you?
Who am I? Who is Kyle Montgomery? Man, that's a very complicated question.
That's tough, right? Just start with where you're from.
I'm a father. Well, from Kansas City, originally, okay. Kansas City, Kansas. But I've spent the last 10 years living in Los Angeles. My career took me there. Right. So I'm a lot of things. I'm a sports broadcaster. I'm a hooper at heart. I'm a father. I'm a world traveler. I'm a philosophist. I'm a lot of things.
Living the dream, right?
Yeah, living the dream. But again, most people, they recognize me as a play-by-play commentator. So that's my main thing. That's my passion. That's what's really taken me around the world, doing FIBA 3x3 as the voice, commentating, you know, this game that we hope continues to rise up.
Nice, man. That's dope. That's dope.
Tell us, how does a day in your life looks like?
It's varied. When I'm on the road, it's super busy. You know, I'm usually spending a lot of my time studying. Most people think that, you know, I'm showing up to the games, and by the style of my commentary, it's so kind of loose. They don't know that I put a lot of research in. So I'm studying the rosters and the stats and the history of not only the teams, but the players as well. I'm refreshing on what happened in this particular city last year, back in 2015, so that I can always add context to the game. Because as you know, I'm the only broadcaster. You know, I don't have a partner, it's just me.
Yeah.
So I have to be able to fill these games with a lot of information outside of just the action that's happening in front of me. Mm. You know, I gotta give people context of the history of between these two teams and what this player has done, how this player has developed into who he is now. You could take Dimes, for example. I can tell people Dimes' history when he came on in 2018 and how he was the young lion and how he was meek, and now, you know, how his career has changed and the progression from him.
Yeah.
So
Now
he's the big dog. You know, now he's Mufasa, staying alive though. You know what I mean? But he was little Simba, you know?
And when you do that, when you do the research on all the things, do you like write it on a piece of paper and take it with you to the game, or do you just memorize it?
Oh no, it's too many teams to memorize everything. There's some things that stick with me.
Yeah.
Just big moments over the years and covering the game, you know, stories about certain players, you know, those never leave me. But as far as who's leading in player value, which team is shooting the best two-point percentage, who's leading in rebounds, you know, so if you try to memorize all that stuff, that'll get a little foggy. So I put the notes in my computer. A lot of times, you know, I've got long flights from the United States over to Europe, and, you know, I spend those 10 or 12 hours instead of sleeping. Most of them, I'm on the computer. I'm going through each team, each player.
Dedication.
Boom.
You fly a lot, don't you? How much flights do you take in a year?
Man, I'd say anywhere between probably 20 to 30 flights a year. Because
you actually see the world.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Especially this year. Like, this year, since March, I've been to Venice, Italy. I've been to London. I've been to New York. I've been to Manila, Philippines. I just left Lausanne, Switzerland. We were in Prague before that. I was in Dominican Republic.
But when you go there, do you just stay for the games, or do you stay a little bit longer, or you come a bit earlier to explore?
If it works schedule-wise, I try to get an extra day either on the front end of the tournament or the back end of the tournament to where I can actually just enjoy the city.
Yeah.
You know, I'm there for a job, and that's to call the games. But it would be a waste to go around the world and not be able to immerse yourself in the culture. So for me, it was really important because I've never traveled outside of the country before FIBA 3x3.
Okay, nice.
All of my work was in the United States.
And,
you know, where I'm from, you know, I grew up with very little. So nobody in my family had a passport. Yeah. I didn't know what a passport was until I was a grown person, because it was never worthy of a discussion where I'm from. So now that when I became a grown man and I came into this opportunity and I started to travel, it opened up my eyes in a way that I never anticipated. So I made sure, like, yo, when you go to these places, don't waste it. Don't just go there and just work. Go out, try the food.
Yeah, man.
Try to learn a few words of the language.
Yeah, talk
to somebody that lives there. Learn what the culture is about.
I heard that.
Been one of the biggest benefits of, you know, this job with 3x3.
That's nice, man. Yeah.
And
you said you were talking about your environment. Where did you grow up? Take us a bit back. In what environment did you grow up? Tell us about it.
Man, I'll give it. Y'all want me to give it to y'all raw?
You're raw, man.
Okay. I grew up in Kansas City.
Just share what you want to share.
Okay.
Because there are a lot of people just watching
sure.
that have ambitions and stuff like that. So.
Sure, but you know, I want my story to be able to inspire people too.
Yeah.
And I want to show people that, you know, you can make something of yourself if you commit your mind to it. But I grew up as rough as they come. If you watch American TV and you look at some of the inner cities where drugs are everywhere, you know, people, you got guns, there's always that threat of violence around you. That was me. I grew up, I'll show you some old pictures of me, you won't believe it. But grew up rough in the streets, Kansas City, you know, a lot of family members, a lot of friends involved in the activities that, you know, usually lead to nothing. But those were my people.
Yeah.
So I had to grow up in that environment and try to find a way out. I didn't want to be like the people around me. And then both of my parents struggled with drug addiction. You know, I had to deal with a lot. You know, from heating my bath water up on the stove, putting it in a tub, doing my homework with candlelight because we ain't got no lights. Even to this day, some people want to talk about old school NBA games that they watched coming up, and I didn't have a TV half the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't relate on some of those things, but just giving you an idea of that type of environment, that's what I came from. Always loved basketball. I looked at basketball as a way kind of out, but I didn't grow to be as big as I wanted to be. 6'3" is hard to get to the league. I'm no Chris Paul, you know what I'm saying? But anyway, I wanted to make a success out of myself in some way. And I never knew that it was going to be broadcasting. I just knew the first step was getting out of the hood and going to college. Getting an education, that would be the first step.
Yeah.
And then when I went to college, you know, my third year in college, one of my professors convinced me to try broadcasting.
Yeah.
Because initially when I went to college, I wanted to be a radio DJ.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm like, I'm going to college. What can I do when I go to college? Okay, I like music. Okay. I got a pretty good sounding voice, people were telling me even back then. And my professor was like, look, man, you do have a good voice, but you're gonna probably do better for yourself if you try to do TV, become a sports broadcaster. So I took a risk. I learned the craft of sports broadcasting at an internship, and I got lucky right out of college. I got hired to do to be a sports broadcaster for a TV station in Mississippi.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, this dream of me coming from, you know, the bottom, it, you know, was like, maybe I can really do this. And sure enough, once I graduated college, my career and my life took off in a way that I couldn't have anticipated.
Damn.
And what was the defining moment that you was like, all right, this is gonna be fun from now on? Like, your career just
all
went
right.
to the sky.
So when I got my job with the NBA, I was 24 years old, 2 years out of college. I had very little experience, but I was so motivated to become good. So I started off in this small station in Mississippi, Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Tiny, tiny town. I mean, it's where people that don't know how to do TV have to start.
Yeah.
Because you can't start on a big channel in a big city because those people expect a certain level of delivery and professionalism. So you have to kind of learn. So I learned, I had some hard lessons. I had a show in Mississippi that if YouTube was popping back then, it would be viral now. It was the worst show ever. but it's what propelled me. I had a show one night where I lost the teleprompter, and I also didn't have any paper scripts with me.
Yeah.
And they put me on air one night, and I lost that, and I didn't know what to say. I'm on live TV for 5 minutes, and I'm just saying, live. I'm 22 at the time, and I thought my career was over.
Yeah.
And my boss, they took me off air for 3 weeks. They told me, we can't put you back on camera for 3 weeks. We got to feel sure that we can trust you if you get back on camera. And in that 3 weeks, it lit a fire in me. And I came back, 3 weeks later, they put me back on air, and I was so sharp. I was ready. I wanted the teleprompter to go out again so I could show them, like, yeah, I'm ready now. I learned a very valuable lesson about the difference between being a communicator and a broadcaster at a young age. So had I communicated, I would have told the audience, like, yo, I apologize. I lost my teleprompter tonight, and I don't have any paper scripts. Can you bear with me for the rest of the broadcast if you can? But instead, I try to pretend like, nothing was wrong. I'm sitting there trying to stumble and mumble and bumble my way through it. But anyway, that night, it propelled me in a way to where I refused to make, I didn't want to make any more mistakes. And 6 months later, they gave me a promotion. A year after that, another job called me to offer me a job in Montgomery. And then the NBA called. That's when everything changed for me. I go from, some dude from the hood to now my coworkers are Charles Barkley and Chris Webber and Reggie Miller. I remember walking to NBA's campus, 24 years old, I'm making more money than I ever thought I could make.
Yeah.
Anybody in my family could ever think of. And I'm walking in, and Gary Payton and Chris Webber are standing right there. And I'm coming in, I'm like, man, I watch these dudes on TV. Now I got to do a show with this dude.
Yeah.
Introduce myself, and Gary Payton's looking at me like, yo, what's up? Who's this? They like, yo, this is Kyle Montgomery. He's our new hire. He's going to be doing NBA Digital and doing some shows. And, they kind of looked me up and down like, okay. And I was just like a little intimidated at first.
I can understand.
But, I fit in there. They started me to do a show with Brent Berry and Dennis Scott, and I'm doing NBA Game Time with Chris Webber and Reggie Miller and Cheryl Miller. Eric Snow worked there at the time, and I felt like I had made it.
Yeah. Well, what exactly did you have to do? Did you have to do at in the NBA?
So, I did a show, two shows. I did a show called The Jump on NBA.com. It was a digital show. And I did a show called NBA Game Time, which they still do now. I did that on Saturdays, but since I was the young person, I didn't do it 5 days a week. Mm-hmm. I got one show on TV per week, and I got one digital show per week. And the rest of my work, which is why I have the job with 3x3 now, was on NBA.com. I did the top 10 plays. Mm-hmm. So that's when I started to get like a following internationally. And the crazy thing is I didn't even like to do the highlights because I would have to stay up till 2 or 3 in the morning because we had to wait for the games to end on the West Coast of the United States. There's a 3-hour difference.
Yeah.
NBA TV's in Atlanta, so we're Eastern time zone, but we had to wait for the Lakers games, the Clippers games to end on the West Coast. So they would be ending like 1 a.m. our time. They would have to cut the video, blah, blah, blah. So I didn't like having to stay up late. I'm like, man, I'm the only person on the whole staff that got to do these stupid highlights. I'm here at 2 a.m., But what it did was it provided an opportunity for me to have like a loose approach. So it's 2 in the morning. I got two producers with me. They're like, look, man, it's 2 a.m. We're doing the highlights. Just have some fun with these, man.
Yeah.
Just have some fun. Nobody's in the building but us. So I said, I am going to have some fun with these highlights. So I started to be creative in some of the things I was saying on the top 10 plays and top 10 highlights. And all of a sudden, people started to come back to me and saying, yo, what you said last night on the top 10, they're talking about it on the page. Oh, what that thing you said, like, boom, I was coming up with all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
And it wasn't just the audience in the United States. These were people all over the world that had access to these highlights now, on a digital platform.
Yeah.
You can go to NBA.com and it's there. YouTube is there. And I'm like, whoa. It was the first time that it clicked with me. Like, man, you're reaching people in Netherlands and Finland, Australia. They send in comments. Like, yeah, they like your stuff. So I did that for 3 years. And people started to recognize me from that. I also had a show on Cartoon Network, too, a basketball show on Cartoon Network called Run It Back. Look it up. You'll see. I was a young me with no beard. But
Run It Back.
Oddly enough, I ended up leaving the NBA after almost 4 years there.
Yeah.
And, you know, my career took me elsewhere. And I never thought that anything would come of it. But FIBA 3x3 ended up hiring me 2 years after I left the NBA.
Why did you leave the NBA?
Contract issues, man.
Yeah.
They wanted me back. I wanted to come back, but I had been doing this. I had been doing it for 3.5 years at that time, and I wanted to get more shows on NBA TV. I like to do the highlights, but I didn't like being up there so late at night. I felt like after 3 years, you know, I was young at the time. So after 3 years, I'm thinking, man, I earned my spot to be able.
And how old were you at this point?
So I started there when I was 24. So I'm 27 at this time. And I'm thinking, okay, if I'm gonna renew my contract, I want another show on NBA TV. Yeah. I want a little bit more of the big boy responsibility.
Yeah, because so, you showed them what you got, so.
Yeah.
Now they gotta take a chance.
There were some things that were promised to me that didn't come through.
Yeah.
I felt a little betrayed by it a little bit. And I said, you know what? I have enough experience. I've done this for 3.5 years. I was on Cartoon Network. People have seen me on NBA TV. I can take this experience and somebody will give me a job somewhere else. And that's what I did. I said, you know what? Keep the contract. If y'all want to leave the highlights and to somebody else, then go ahead.
Yeah.
I'm going to take my talents elsewhere. So I did. And my journey ended up leading me to FIBA 3x3, which I didn't.
How did that happen?
Random. So when I left the NBA, I went to a station in Charlotte. Got paid more money, by the way. At a young age, I was like, that was my driving force. But anyway, went to Charlotte. It's understandable. But I can teach you some lessons about that, about money and the things that it brings and what's valuable and what's not. I learned that. You know, being able, like going to the NBA and being able to buy the Mercedes and the Range Rovers, and I'm partying with the stars, and I'm eating the steak and shrimp dinners at night, and you know, I'm getting a taste of what they say the life is. You know, this was my life at that time. But I started to realize, you know, after you have that Mercedes, when you first buy it, nobody can eat French fries in it. Everybody, you got it. You're very particular about don't put your fingers on the windows. But after you have it for 6 months, all of a sudden, you don't pay so much attention to it. All of a sudden, it becomes just a car. It's just a car. So these things that people invest their energy into and they work their whole lives to get, soon they realize that Mercedes isn't gonna bring you happiness. After a while, you're gonna get tired of eating lobster for dinner and steak for dinner. It's like, steak again? You know, but when I was young, I dreamed of being able to have that for dinner. This is the goal. The thing is, most people don't attain this until they get older in life. So they spend most of their life trying to get these things.
Yeah.
I was fortunate to get these things young at 24 years old, to have a really high salary at 24 years old and experience like, okay, now I'm touching some money. And now I'm touching some of the things that they say are supposed to make you happy, but it really doesn't. So then I learned that, okay, the things that make you happy are being able to help somebody achieve a goal that pays you for a lifetime. You know, being able to accomplish something with a group of people or something individually, you know, those things will pay you forever, you know. So I changed my focus in that regard, but in a long way, I'm back to your question on how to get to the next three. I just had to give you that game about how I learned that lesson.
Yeah.
But I'm 2 years removed from the NBA. I'm now working in Los Angeles. I took a job with Fox Sports to cover the Clippers, NBA games, and with the NFL.
Like, and live during the games?
Oh, well, I did the pregame shows. What, y'all won't remember this dude. His name is Corey Maggette. He used to play for the Clippers. He was an all-star. But anyway, I got hired to do a show with him for Fox Sports. I traveled with the Clippers. Everywhere they flew, I flew. So I'm flying private. Chris Paul is sitting right next to me. Blake Griffin's right here. DeAndre Jordan's up here. I had their schedule. That was my job. I was the team's broadcaster. Mm-hmm. So I'm doing that with the Clippers.
Does every team have an own broadcaster, or is it just a special?
Does
every team have a broadcaster, or was it just something special?
Most teams have a broadcast. Like in the big markets, the New York Knicks have their own team, their own channel. The Clippers do. Some of the small market teams don't. But they worked out a deal with Fox Sports to where they said, okay, we want a pregame show, we want a postgame show. We don't want people watching ESPN. We want a broadcast that's focused specifically on our team, that we can travel with the team, we can set up a show, boom, boom, boom. So that was my thing.
That's nice, man.
And anyway, I'm doing that. And also while I'm there, the NFL Network hired me too to be a sports anchor for them. So I'm working for the Clippers and the NFL.
Like in the same city?
Same city, damn. LA, right. I thought life was good in Atlanta when I went to the NBA. When I went to LA, life really, really changed. Now it just really changed. Now I'm in LA and it's crazy. But anyway, we won't get into that. Right? But, you know, I get a random email one day from this guy named George Bucur. He lives in Romania. This guy, George Bucur, and another guy named Julian DeBove, they used to watch the NBA.com highlights years ago when I used to do it. And they weren't even working for FIBA at the time. Mm-hmm. But once they started working with FIBA and they had this idea of trying to grow this game, this urban sports from the streets to the Olympics, they were like, look, we used to listen to this guy on NBA.com and he kind of had a little bit of a street flavor to him.
Yeah.
This game is from the streets. So let's see if we can contact him and see if he'll do this 3x3. So they found my email on LinkedIn, shot me an email, told me a little bit about 3x3, told me they were interested in me doing play-by-play for this game that they were trying to grow.
Yeah.
I'm working for the NFL and the NBA at the time, so I'm like,
yeah.
I mean, come on. I 3x3, what is this?
Yeah.
Is this? I had no idea. But they showed me the list of countries that they go to, and it kind of sparked my interest a little bit. I'm like, man, I've done some things in the States, but I haven't really traveled the world. And I'm looking at you know, Paris, and I'm looking at some Mexico City and some of these other places. And I'm like, maybe I should entertain this a little bit. Anyway, my first year was 2015. They invited me out to do one tournament just to see if they liked me and see if I liked it. And I went to Switzerland and Mexico City that year. And I almost fell in love from the very beginning. They flew me out there. I had never done play-by-play in my whole life. I did the highlights on NBA.com, but it's different recording highlights than it is calling a live game.
Yeah.
You know, so I told them, I said, I've never done this before. I've been on TV and I know how to do that, but it ended up working out. I saw the potential of the game, not really the players. The players weren't top level to me.
True.
I was covering the NBA. It's a very big difference between covering the league and then coming and covering, say, Piran in 3x3. It's like, who are these dudes, you know? So I saw the potential of the game, the rules, how fast it could go. And I was thinking to myself, man, if we get the USA players to adopt this game, this thing could be crazy.
Yeah,
we're going to be seeing dunks, crossovers, twos all day long. So maybe I should stick with it just a little bit and just see kind of where it goes, if I could fit it into my schedule with what I'm already doing. So that's why the first year I only did two tournaments. And then the second year they called me back and they was like, look, man, can you do all of them? We got the world tour going and blah, blah, blah. And I ended up negotiating a way to where I could do those tournaments along with the jobs that I had in the United States.
Yeah.
And boom, 16. That's when I started to kind of get my feet wet. I wasn't really nice on the mic back then. I only like listening to the 2016 games. Yeah. I was different. I wasn't quite comfortable in doing and approaching the game as I approach it.
And how old were you at this point?
2016, I was, man, you got me doing quick math. 30.
Gotta get to work.
I was on, I was 30 something.
33.
Yeah, 33, something like that. Wait, 16 was what, 6 years ago? 32.
Yeah.
Yeah, 32. Yeah.
So at this point, you were and doing the tournaments for FIBA and doing the work for Clippers and NFL at the same time.
Same time. Same time.
How much free time did you have?
Very little, man. I remember getting off planes coming from 3x3 tournaments and literally not going home, going straight over to the NFL network, changing into my suit, and having a show in 2 hours.
Damn.
I'd study the NFL on the plane on the way back from a 3x3 tournament.
Yeah.
Or I'd leave NFL network and go straight to the airport to fly to a 3x3 tournament. So my schedule was pretty crazy. And you know, at the time I had, you know, I got a 14-year-old son, he's 14 now, and I have a 7-year-old daughter. So, you know, getting home and spending enough time with them and managing the work schedule and all that, it was difficult. But, you know, I found a way. You know, I was always a hustler. Like, it was the only thing I knew from the time I was small. So that grind at all cost mentality, it carried into adulthood for me.
I hear that.
So I was like, look, I'm trying to, number one, earn a good living to where I can provide for my then wife. I'm not married anymore, but provide for my, you know, my family at the time, so that they could have everything that they needed and wanted and everything else. So, I hope I answered your question with that.
Yeah. No, it was a good answer.
Damn.
And like you mentioned, you had like a really hectic time schedule, so to say, because you have to travel, you have to be ready all the time. Maybe you didn't even sleep that day. But what are the most experience that you, when you look back, you'd be like, all right, I will never forget about this.
The most crazy experience.
The most craziest experience. Or most fun.
I can't tell you about them on the podcast. Turn the microphone off and I'll give you a couple stories. It's been what? No, there have been several just over the course of my career in general.
Yeah.
But in terms of 3x3 on the court, 2016 World Championships, I think that's when I first realized how serious Serbia takes the game and how big of a target there is on the United States back, even if they aren't considered to be the best team. So they played for the gold medal. And at that time, the USA team had this dude named Mike Henry on it. They had Alfonso McKinney, he plays in the league right now. You know, these dudes, they came on that year on the Pro Tour, and I think they won like 15 straight. Nobody could stop them. They was dunking on people's heads. They had this guard, his name was Stefan Hanna. He was throwing oops. If you ever look back to the highlights of the 2016 World Cup, you'll see Stefan Hanna throw it through a dude's legs and then throw a no-look oop to Alfonso McKinney, who almost tore the rim down. That's the type of team they were. And the Serbians, they had taken note, and they like, you know, Dušan Bulut and his squad, they were the best team then, and they're like, oh, we're gonna show these Americans what this game is. And I thought the USA was gonna smack them. Like, these dudes were just too tough.
I can remember that game.
They was too tough. They was 6'5", they was blocking everybody's shot, they was shooting at people. I said, Serbia can't beat these dudes. But I learned about the heart of Dušan Bulut at early, and I learned about the difference in 3x3. Really, it resonated with me then, because the American team was the more talented team. 1 through 4, they were more talented, they were bigger, they were faster, everything. But the Serbians understood how to play 3x3 better. You can't come into this game with all the physical tools and just expect to win. There's a strategy to understanding how to play this game. And the Serbians displayed that in the gold medal game. They picked them apart, they played the game smart, and only fittingly, Dushan hits the game winner, I think in Mike Henry's face. And I remember seeing Dushan when he won it, it was like he won the NBA title. He's banging on his chest, he's looking in the crowd, the Serbians in the crowd are going crazy. And you could just see the pride of the people of that country. This game's not a joke to them. This is for real for them. And I don't think for the American team, they understood what it really, really was. And I saw that game and I was like, I ain't got nothing but respect for the Serbians, but I got a whole new outlook on this game too. It's like, this is the real deal. You gotta know how to play this if you're gonna win. So
yeah.
that one definitely really stood out to me. Even here in Amsterdam, like, we've had some great, great national competitions here, from the World Cup to the Europe Cup.
Yeah.
Mike Hicks winning the bronze medal against Serbia in 2019. If y'all ain't seen that, go back and look at the highlights. Money in the Bank was a bucket. I'm talking about he could score 10, 12 points on you.
Damn.
He averaged 10 a game most of the tournaments.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
And Poland had never beat Serbia. Never beat them. And he hit that game-winning shot falling on his back against Serbia to earn the first medal for Poland. That was one I'll never forget. Those are just a couple of many.
Damn. Goosebumps, man. Hearing that story.
I've seen a lot, man.
And at this point, you're only working for FIBA right now or still doing the Clippers and NFL?
I just stopped doing NFL. At the end of last season. So this will be the first time in eight years that I'm not doing NFL.
Shit.
I focus solely on 3x3 going forward.
Yeah.
Because back to my lesson, young fellas, about learning what's important. The money would be in the United States. They offer the big jobs, the big platforms, boom. But FIBA 3x3 offered me an opportunity to essentially, they gave me the keys and they said, Kyle, just be you. Do your thing, be creative, have fun.
Yeah.
Of course, I can't make as much money doing this as I would do with the NFL, but I've done that in my career. I've been doing this for almost 17 years. So, yeah. You know, I've experienced making the big money. And in case FIBA ever listens to this, they take good care of me. Don't get me wrong now.
Yeah.
I'm not necessarily rubbing pennies with 3x3. They take care, but it's a different beast there. But anyway, I had to make a decision in my life because the NFL didn't want to compete with 3x3 because the schedules conflict.
Yeah.
You know, they needed me on Sundays, which is the big game day for the NFL. And oftentimes, once 3x3 is in season, we're playing on weekends. So I have to be out of country for a lot of the, you know, especially the early part of the season. And they said, listen, we will like you, but you got to make a decision here. So I thought long and hard about it. And I said, Kyle, you got to go with, what does your heart tell you? Where's your heart? Not the money. Because if the money is a thing, you know where you're going to go. Where's your heart tell you? What fulfills you? You know, what are the benefits of staying with 3x3 versus, you know, living in LA and continue to do the NFL. And I said, I couldn't walk away from the opportunity to continue to experience the world. You can't put a price tag on that. You can't quantify the cultural benefits of sitting down and doing a podcast in Amsterdam from a dude that's from the hood in Kansas City. The NFL can't provide that to me. The NFL can't provide to me my own chair to where I'm the voice of this game. When I sit down, I'm comfortable. I say, hey, what's good? We're here at the third Masters of the season. That's what I do. But when I'm with the NFL, it's a little more corporate. I got to wear a suit. I have to speak a certain way. They tell you how to shave your facial hair.
Yeah.
It's different. And this was more appealing to me. So I made the decision. I said, go with your heart. 3x3, sorry, NFL. It was a good 8 years. I certainly enjoyed it. But this is where my heart is. You know, we've done the Olympics. I see great things in the future for 3x3.
Yeah.
And I'm in a good position because I've been calling play-by-play now for seven you know, for 7 years. And thankfully, I've developed a relationship with the audience of listeners who listen worldwide. Yeah. And it was no way I could turn my back on them for a big check. So I'm here. Ain't that what we say here? We here?
Yeah.
So I'm here. That's what.
Nice, man.
That's a nice man.
But okay, if I understand that.
That's what it is.
If I understand well, you have been doing it for 7 years right now, right?
Yep.
How do you feel about the game of 3x3? Like, you already explained a bit, but yeah, just give it to us. How do you feel about the game of 3x3? Because if I'm correct, you also played 5 against 5 back in the States.
Yeah, right. I was a decent player. I know we be shooting around a little bit. You can't tell. But it's early. I just woke up.
It looked a bit rough.
Hey, it looked a little rough. Hey, but it looked a little rough for y'all too.
We gonna keep it real. We're gonna make you feel comfortable. So
no, but the game is the game of 3x3 has really evolved. It's from when I first started to cover it to now, I'm seeing better athletes, better players on each team. The understanding of the game has changed. It was really physical when I first started, like, to where now the game, I mean, on every level, it's elevated. The officiating's gotten better. The players that we're seeing now interested in the game are better. These aren't just dads that are doing something because they're not playing 5-on-5 anymore. No, these are, you know, especially in the States, we got some top level dudes, some dudes that have touched the NBA that are interested in playing the game. You know, the way people are playing the game now, it's faster. You don't see the bigs. You know, when I first started, shout out to Boz Rosendahl, the Mountain. You could throw that rock down to Big Boz and he was gonna dunk on anybody's head. And you could run your offense through your big. But now the game has turned, you gotta be able to shoot. Now it's extended. You gotta be able to knock down too. So now a Big Boz Rosendahl, again, shout out to my guy, he may not work so well because while he can dominate inside the arc, this game is really more about twos. It's almost like the NBA has turned to more of a three-point game. Yeah, you've got to be able to keep up with the pace in a sprint to 21.
The game evolved.
So now you need four players that are very versatile. They can move on the perimeter, they can defend, they can rebound, they can score. So a 7-footer, for example, is going to find it a little bit more difficult because now, you know, after you score your one, you got to transition out. Deep. Yeah. Now you're gonna guard that 6'4" dude that's got handle and a quick step on the perimeter because you're either gonna get beat on the baseline or beat on the drive or he gonna be shooting twos uncontested. So I've seen the game go from that where we had a couple 7-footers. We had the Birdman who played for Ljubljana. You know, it's a couple of bigs that kind of dominated at that time. So I've seen the game change drastically to now more women's teams are hooping. A better level of talent is now on the women's series with, I think, 11 events this year. And so
nice.
In seven years, the game has changed a lot, and I think it's for the better.
Yeah. And how do you see the future of 3x3 basketball?
I think it's bright.
Going?
That's why I brought these shades, bro.
Yeah!
It's the future, all jokes aside, the future is bright. I think we made a really good impression with the Olympics last summer. People got to see the game on a global stage, the biggest global sporting stage in the world for the first time. And the impressions that I got were all positive. People were like, oh man, I liked that 3x3 thing. It was one of the talks of the Olympics. So I think that is now a springboard to propelling the game even further now. So now people are going to be anticipating it in the next Olympic Games in Paris. Now we're going to get more eyeballs on the Pro Tour. You're going to get more eyeballs on all the action here in each individual country where they're trying to grow the game.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking we're going to grow some stars. People are going to continue to love the game. I mean, it's a positive outlook. Yeah, going forward.
Is there a Hall of Fame already for 3x3 basketball?
There should be.
Yes, but
the job.
Oh, no, for sure. The job. Look, I remember covering, like I said, the early teams. You're talking about Shirt and Joey Shelvis and Jesper and Boz and, you know, seeing that group, especially early on.
The OGs.
These dudes, they paved the way. And they didn't, and you can't pave the way without having some success. So you look at their medal cabinet, you see what they did at the World Cup, you see the silvers, you see they were always a top three team. Every tournament that they played in, they were right there.
Yeah.
So they built the foundation. They pick and roll you to death. I remember you, Amsterdam, if it was two things they was gonna do, they was gonna pick and roll your ass to death, and they was gonna defend the heck out of you.
Yeah, man, intensity was high.
That's what they did.
Pick and roll in the ass like
yo,
this.
Hey, those picks hurt?
Of course, and they strong, and yo. Look. And you get some highlights too. Like, you know, the Flying Dutchman, he dunk on somebody's head. He wouldn't even celebrate. He just dunk on somebody and just keep playing.
Like, that's what I do daily. It's normal.
He was. You know, on up to, you know, when Aaron Royer came on.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Dimes came in as a young player too. To now all the new guys, you know, Arvin Slachter and, you know, his shooting ability, Maxim Kovacevic, I know he comes from Serbia, but seeing the team kind of transform and what they've done here.
Yeah.
I've seen the Dutch the federation here, the effort that they put in terms of growing the youth. I've been seeing that for years. So I kind of known that the Netherlands was onto something. Years ago, I'm like, oh man, y'all got your own 3x3 courts out here? Man, it ain't a lot of countries that really got that going on. Oh man, y'all got youth development camps already? This was years ago.
Yeah, man.
You know, my first time coming to Amsterdam was 2017. We did the Europe Cup here. That's when Lasmanis and Miezis, y'all know Riga, the Latvians, that's when they first, that was their first coming out, big coming out party was 2017 here. But anyway, that's when I first started to recognize, like, yo, the Netherlands is on to something.
I heard that.
5 years from now, you know, they're going to be really developing or presenting some talent coming out of here. And now, you know, with 3x3 Next and 3x3 Unites, and obviously the 3x3 Pro League, which I'm going to be doing, I'm seeing it live time right now.
Yeah.
Jesper's gone from being a player that I used to call his games. Now he's the big dog.
He's the big dog, and he's fixing all the events.
Right. You know, now he's running the show. Now we got pro level events here. We got the Utrecht Masters coming up this year.
Yeah.
That's all been booked.
Are you also there?
Of course.
Come on, man.
Stupid question, man.
Come on now.
I'm going to be there.
What's 3x3 basketball without the big dog?
No.
Come on now.
All the big events and.
Yeah.
Even some of the second level events I'm starting to do now because, again, 3x3 is the only thing I'm doing.
Yeah.
But, yeah, shout out to the Netherlands. My guard, Martin's probably listening to this. Martin. All the effort that's gone in to creating 3x3 and growing it here and growing it with the youth.
Yeah.
It's important because you can draw a lot of parallels from 3x3 to real life. You can learn a lot. Just in this game and the things that you have to do and facing adversity and high, you know, thinking quick in high pressure situations.
Yeah.
You don't have a coach in this game, so
you gotta
problem solve amongst each other.
Yeah, man.
These are things that you can carry from the 3x3 court into life. You see what I'm saying?
I heard it. And to go on that, like at 3x3 Unites, we use 3x3 as a tool to teach life skills to the youth, to the young people. What life skill is important for you, and what made you the person you are today?
There's a couple of them. Courage, number one. I had to have courage to take some of the steps that I took in my life. You know, when people were saying, "Oh man, you can't do that."
Yeah.
And then the self doubt too. It's like, man, can I really get on TV and speak well enough to have that job? I'm from the hood. We speak a certain way in the hood.
Yeah, you know, put
me on in front of a camera where I'm talking to hundreds of thousands of people. Do you really got the courage to travel around the world with no example from your family?
Yeah.
I'm in the middle of China. Can you, you got the courage to go over there and communicate with people and actually, so that's a life skill. And I got a tattoo. You can't see it right now, but my tattoo, it's an ace card. It says never fold. So never fold just means never give up. It's a unrelenting desire to keep going, even when stuff gets hard. You know, even when life is hitting you in the face with all kinds of obstacles, like, just always never fold, never fold. Look at yourself like, I'm the ace card. The ace card is the highest. So, you know, 3x3 is like that too. You face so much adversity, you tired as hell out there. 10 minute sprint, you gotta defend after you just made a shot. Your tank is empty, but you still got 2 minutes to go. And it's a 2-point game. You gonna fold, or you gonna find what it takes to dig deep inside yourself and play it out, that sprint to 21. You know, my life is like that too. So I'm never folding. You're gonna have to pull me off that court. Just like in life, I'm gonna fight until I can't fight no more. I'm never folding. So those two, I know you asked for one, but I'm a little long-winded. Yeah. So I'm gonna give you two.
No, man, nice, man. Like, actually hearing that from you feels a bit different, because you have like seen a lot of tournaments. You have like seen the growth of 3x3 at every tournament every year. Mm-hmm. So hearing that from you, it feels a little bit different than, like, I already knew it, but now hearing it from you, it brings a different perspective for me.
Man, that's what it's all about. This experience that I'm getting, I like to share it when I can, because you never know how it might affect somebody. You know, you never know that, because when people meet me, I'm not putting on any frills. I'm not faking or anything like that. I came in here, I was 100 with y'all from the very beginning. I'm an authentic guy. It's where I come from. It's what I know. I'm not gonna do the phony stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I know in LA, it's very common for people to do the Hollywood talk. No, I'm 100, I'm from the streets. I made some moves that helped my career. I've now traveled the world. I've got some wisdom that I can share with people from everywhere that they may be able to relate to. And it's to inspire them. Like, if I could do it, it's all about your mentality. You know, be willing to learn, be teachable, and you can go far. You can go far. And never fold.
Never fold.
Never fold. I don't care what life throws at you. Never fold.
I like that, man. I like that.
You got the ace card. You the ace card.
Okay. Let's say you were currently here for the Pro League in Amsterdam. What do you expect of that?
Man, you know, I'm actually anxious because, you know, we got several teams that I've covered on a regular basis. We got New York Harlem with Disco Damo and company coming back. Antwerp, which has become one of the most exciting teams in the league. Must see
good.
TV.
They're getting hot.
I think they fully loaded. Amsterdam's gonna be there. I just saw them make a run in Lausanne. I think we got another American team like Omaha.
They just
won in Quebec, I think.
Yeah, I saw that.
They just won in Quebec, so they'll be here. Zamun, Serbian squad, they're gonna be here. I haven't seen some of the other like Dutch talent.
Yeah.
So I wanna see like,
going on.
Yeah, a lot of these faces are gonna be new to me.
Oh yeah.
So.
A lot of new faces.
Yeah, a lot of new faces. So I'm.
But they're talented. Yeah, the games.
I'm eager to see it.
Like the past two pro leagues, like in Utrecht and The Hague.
Yeah.
The games were hot. The game was hot. So.
They can play.
So, you know, I'm ready. I got a few bars I've thought about that I'm gonna drop while I'm here. So today I'll get in the lab tonight. The games start tomorrow. I hope I don't date the podcast by saying that, but. The games start Tuesday.
Yeah, no, that's
okay. It's fine.
Okay. So, yeah, I'm going to get in the lab and get ready. I'm anxious, so.
Nice, man. And is this your first time in Amsterdam?
No. This is my fourth.
Fourth, okay.
Yeah, fourth time in Amsterdam.
And have you seen it a little bit?
A little bit. You know, I've seen it on a surface level. I've been really busy the previous times I've come, like Europe Cup, World Cup. I think I came last year, but it was for a short time. Mm-hmm. So I've seen the Rijksmuseum from the outside. I've seen the Van Gogh. I've been to Museumplein. I've gone through, I've gotten on a boat and gone through the canals a little bit. I've done some of the touristy things.
I haven't even seen the Anne Frank.
Yeah. See? You didn't go to school?
See?
No, I don't think so, man. I don't think so.
So I've done that, but I think I actually want to go inside the Rijksmuseum this time.
Yeah.
Now I want to go in, what's the park? Vondelpark.
Vondelpark.
Yeah.
Yeah, the big park.
Beautiful. I've been there. So look, I've touched a little bit of it.
Yeah, I've touched a little bit of it.
But, you know, I want to get a little bit further.
How do you feel about the people in Amsterdam?
The Dutch people are cool, man. Everybody's cool, man. Like, I haven't run into anybody that's been rude or, you know, kind of standoffish. There's been some places I've gone where, you know, they let me know, like, yeah, we don't like you that much. Mm. But here, everybody's cool. Everybody's offering me stroop waffles and stuff. You know, everybody. So I'm getting my share of that. I've had the pancakes here, and people always offer me, like, ideas to have different experiences and stuff and stuff like that. So I got a lot of love for the people here in Amsterdam. Yeah.
My man.
Maybe one day I may even move out here.
Hey, people, you heard it here first. The voice is moving to Amsterdam. We got him in the backyard.
Maybe. So. Maybe. There's a lot to like. There's a lot to like here. There's a lot to like culture.
How do you feel about the bikes?
I like it too. But y'all talking to somebody that, look, I've had to learn a lot. I compare the U.S. to every place that I go.
Yeah.
But I see that people are here a lot more healthy. In America, we got a lot of fast food. We a large percentage of our country is obese.
Yeah.
And I start to look at reasons why. And I say, well, I go over to Europe and people are walking a lot. People are on bikes a lot.
Yeah.
There's a direct correlation there between fitness and health and how you do things. If you're always sitting in the car driving, boom, you get lazy, then it translates to your health.
Yeah, and like food is very expensive over here.
Oh yeah, but you're talking to somebody who lives in Los Angeles, so $9 for a smoothie.
Oh, smoothie?
For a smoothie in the morning. Right. So you can see why, but yeah, the bikes are dope. I want to get on the bike while I'm here. Maybe I'll rent one.
Sure, you should. It's an experience.
I know it's a unique aspect of, you know, Amsterdam in particular. It's known to have all the bikes and
But be careful though, because the people on the bikes, they don't give a fuck about you.
Oh, I know.
Yeah,
this dude almost hit me last night. I was walking. I was like, almost stepped in front of him. Hit his bell, bing, 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 sped on by. Said, dang, bro.
Like crazy.
But okay. Yeah, I think that was it for today, man. We got a lot of nice insights from you. And to be honest, this was a very good podcast, man.
Like, yeah, it's a nice episode.
Thank you.
No, appreciate
and before you. That, we actually want you to give us a little something, just some inspirational words for the youth, something.
Like you gave a lot
like
of
you already
advice.
Did though, like the last one.
You know, but for the people, because they be watching it,
yeah.
They be taking all the life advice that you gave us through the whole episode.
Yeah.
But at the end, we always want like one statement or something that you really want to get off
really
your chest.
You really want to share with them, like a cherry on the top.
I would say, don't get consumed with chasing the most amount of money that you can make. I think life is about, first finding your passion and what really stirs your soul, what you like to do. Find what you like to do and also be realistic about what you're good at. You gotta be able to look at yourself and be able to say, okay, I'm really good at this, but maybe I'm not as good at that. So combine what you're good at with what your passion is, and then let that be the foundation of what you want to do, and the money will then come second.
Yeah.
But that may not be a message for, you know, the people that live here, but that's coming from the United States, where money is the top priority with everything. That's the driving force. But again, you know, you'll find peace, you'll find happiness, you'll find fulfillment in following your heart, following what resonates with you. Not necessarily chasing the biggest bag. You know, if you do something that you love every day, it's almost like you're not even working. You see what I mean?
Yeah, true.
So I will leave that y'all with that.
That's a nice one.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
Knowledge.
I think before we end, I want to thank you that you're here, but we also have a really nice goodie bag for you.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, yeah, for sure. Nice. You cannot come to Amsterdam, come to the HQ without leaving with something.
Oh, I think I might know what I got in when.
Hey, oh, man.
I said one goodie bag, but it seems like it's two.
Oh, I got two? That's love.
Special bag for a special person.
That's right? Love. That's
yeah.
Love. No, I appreciate it. It's an honor for me to come on. I love what y'all doing. As two young brothers, man, helping grow this game. Yeah, y'all on the right track. Oh, y'all hooked me up with the sweatsuits.
Bro.
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on with it. Oh, yeah.
Looking good.
Oh, yeah.
Do you want me to wrap it up?
Or? Yeah, man, let's wrap it up.
Okay.
Are you going to wrap it up or am I going to wrap it up?
Let's both wrap it up.
Nah, do you think, man?
I bet. Before we go off, people, like, share.
Subscribe. You know, let us know what was your favorite moment of the podcast, what life advice you're going to take to heart. And
yeah, man, season three.
Shout out to The Voice, man.
Yeah, man, we're taking this season to the top.
It's all up. I appreciate you.
Let's get it, man. Peace out.